Tucked away in lush wooded acres, complemented by a serene lake and fountain, the premier banquet facility in the western suburbs is the Oak Brook Bath and Tennis Club. 35-foot vaulted ceilings, a double-sided stone fireplace, and floor-to-ceiling windows add to the warmth and tranquility of this elegant clubhouse. Have our exquisite chefs prepare an unparalleled menu for your guests. Mention this commercial and receive a special promotional offer. The Oak Brook Bath and Tennis Club is the ideal setting for your special day.
We're going to reschedule the regular meeting of February 10th, 2009. Is reconvened at, 7:46. Clerk Cruz, may I have your roll call vote?
Trustee Carson.
Here.
Trustee Kennedy.
Here.
Trustee Manaski. Trustee Syed.
Here.
Trustee Sanford. Trustee Woolen.
Here.
And President Craig's here.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, are there any members of the public who wish to address the board at this time?
Yes. The first person is Karen Christensen. This is Mullins Litigation.
Hello.
I don't know if that's turned on.
You have to.
Sorry.
He has a new battery in it.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, board. My name is Karen Christensen. I'm a resident of Oak Brook here. And I've known Joan Mullins for the past probably 11 years. Our children met here in Oak Brook. And we've attended the same preschool at the Oak Brook Park District. And I'm here to tell you I'm very disappointed at what has happened to her. I have to be very honest. Joan is probably one of the most honest people I know. She is a very honorable person. And she never, ever passes judgment on anyone. I'm upset because the village defended her in the Gake lawsuit and suddenly stopped shortly after President Craig took office. I have seen her grief and I have seen her suffering. And I feel that anyone in a capacity of any career that we've all been attended in some type of career, whether we're retired or not, if we go to work and don't have a backup and we feel like we have no insurance behind us, and that we're held personally liable and accountable for every aspect of our job, which we should be, but we should also have some type of malpractice insurance to fall back on. As you remember, the defense litigations and costs were on the agenda and discussed openly. The village defended her, controlled her defense, and unbelievably, while responsible for her defense, settled on its own behalf and not her, all the while assuring her not to worry about it because she was covered. So how could that change? How could the village take this on for almost after 2 years, change its mind? How did the village do this without explanation, negotiation, discussion, or open votes? What was she supposed to do? Not show up? She had to defend herself and the integrity of the Oak Brook Village. This sure seems like some type of political something or another. Whether you like someone, you should have nothing to do with whether the person is defended or not. In the local paper last week, the village manager is quoted as saying he's disappointed in Joan's remarks at the last meeting, and you've tried to resolve them in good faith. If there was any good faith, there would be nothing here to settle. And frankly, I'm disappointed that you would inaccurately refer to a vote repealing an ordinance as having anything to do with it, since well before that meeting, the village took her position that it would no longer defend her. In fact, she came to that board meeting tens, maybe thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars ago to ask the board to reconsider and have a discussion, avoid having to sue, and got nowhere. I sat with Joan on my front porch the night before that meeting, and the poor thing was shaking. I just feel this is unjust. Because it was obvious that the board was relying on wrong information Maybe you should go back and watch the videotape of that meeting where that decision was made. You know, I believe it's never too late to say I made a mistake and correct it and still save money and untold amounts of legal fees. So I leave you with three questions. Who made this decision so the residents know who or whom not to vote for next time around? Why would the village stop covering her defense shortly after President Craig took office? And I just feel that you should really go home and think about your life and feel how, if you were in her shoes, this would actually hurt you or your integrity. Thank you very much for addressing this matter.
Thank you.
The next person is Gerald Woolen. The Friary.
Yes, thank you. In the final minutes of the last board meeting, President Craig criticized the letter that I had written to the Dewings concerning the Maze Lake Friary litigation. My letter was written because a previous Dewings article left room for doubt about whether it was the current board of trustees or a previous board that made the decisions that led to the lengthy and expensive litigation with the DuPage Housing Authority. In my letter, I pointed out that none of the current trustees were on the board when the decision leading to the Friarty lawsuit was made. I also stated that the current trustees worked long and hard to resolve the lawsuits in the best interest of the village. Those are both absolutely true statements. In retrospect, I should have also included President Craig as an active participant in trying to resolve the lawsuit. In his comments at the last meeting, President Craig said that he didn't see me anywhere near or have anything to do with the lawsuit. I would like to comment on his statement. First of all, like every other trustee, I participated in many closed session meetings where important decisions regarding the litigation were made. I was an active participant in those meetings, and the other trustees can confirm that. In addition, when President Craig was out of town on vacation, I participated with Trustee Kennedy in a meeting with the DuPage Housing Authority in an effort to see if a fair settlement could be reached to avoid the costly litigation that was taking place. Also, trustees were encouraged to contact members of the county board to seek their support in resolving this litigation. Because of my prior work, I have excellent contacts with several members of the county board, and in fact, I did contact them and discuss it. As many residents know, we recently considered the purchase of the Friarty property to keep the area as open land. I was the first board member to learn that this might be a possibility. The information was conveyed to Dave Niemeyer, Mike Houlihan, and me in a meeting with two representatives of the Forest Preserve District. In summary, contrary to what President Craig stated at the last meeting, I was an active participant in the process of resolving this litigation. I previously mentioned the efforts that were made to achieve a settlement with the DuPage Housing Authority. Trustee Kennedy played a key role in those discussions. Trustee Kennedy was the one who set up the negotiations by working through one of our state senators. He represented the village in all three negotiating sessions, two with President Craig and one with me. He also drafted a settlement proposal in our efforts to resolve this lawsuit, in an effort to resolve this lawsuit before the trial. President Craig was correct that he was the only member of the current board that testified in court. No other member of the board was called to testify since no other member of the current board was involved in the original decision that led to the lawsuit. There is one other very important item that needs clarification. President Craig stated that the village won on all four counts. While it is very significant that we won on the two damage claims that had the money attached to them, the judge ruled in favor of the DuPage Housing Authority on the claims that current zoning laws are exclusionary and discriminatory. While we are still waiting for the judge's final order, it appears likely the final ruling will permit the DuPage Housing Authority to proceed with their original request for senior housing. Whether the DuPage Housing Authority still desires to proceed is yet to be seen. What disturbed me most about President Craig's comments and the tone in which they were conveyed is that, in my opinion, all of the trustees have worked to establish a good working relationship with President Craig and with each other. After an initial rough start, I believe that President Craig and all of the trustees have worked well together. We have disagreements, but for the most part, we work through them, and I certainly hope that continues. There will always be areas where we disagree, but disagreement can and should take place in an agreeable and professional manner that will create a positive image for Oak Brook. Thank you.
Are there any other comments?
No.
I will have comments during my session after the last thing on all of these things that were addressed tonight. Thank you. The next item is the approval of minutes. There are none at this time. Would you read the consent agenda, Clerk Pruce?
Yes, I'd be happy to. All items on the consent agenda are considered to be routine in nature and will be enacted in one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a board member so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered as the first item after approval of the consent agenda. A. Accounts payable for pay period ending February 6, 2009, $218,955.86. Significant items included in the above. B. Approval of payroll for pay period ending January 24, 2009, $836,013.23. C. Community development referrals. D. Authorization to seek bids or proposals or negotiate contracts. 1. 2009 crack seal project. E. Budget adjustments. F. Ordinance S-1253, an ordinance authorizing a loan to the Sports Corps Fund. G. Briarwood Circle Water Main Replacement Change Order Number 1. H. Ordinance S-1254, an ordinance granting variations for a driveway at 12 Heather Lane in the Village of Oak Brook. I. Ordinance G-822, an ordinance amending Section 12-11-7A of the Zoning Ordinance, McDonald's/JPMorgan Chase Bank, 2121 22nd Street Text Amendment, Sign Regulations, Off-Sign Premises Signs with Cross Access Agreement. J. Ordinance S-1255, an ordinance granting special uses for the outdoor dining and two drive-through lanes in connection with the development of the property located at 2111 Midwest Road in the Village of Oak Brook. K. Ordinance S-1256, an ordinance granting variations for the construction of a ground sign at 2122 22nd Street in the Village of Oak Brook. L. Ordinance S-1257, an ordinance granting variations in connection with the development of a restaurant at 2111 Midwest Road in the Village of Oak Brook. President Craig, that's the consent agenda.
Thank you. Board and commission recommendations, there are none. Unfinished business?
You need a motion.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And any items removed?
Pardon?
Are there any items to be removed from the consent?
Are any items to be removed? You have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Second. Roll call vote.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Minoski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
The next item is board and commission recommendations. There are none. An unfinished business. Confirmation of appointments. There are none at this time. Ordinance and resolutions. Ordinance G-880, an ordinance increasing the electricity tax, and amending Chapter 4 of Title 5 of the Village Code, the Village of Oak Brook, DuPage, and Cook County. Trustee Woolen, would you please present the ordinance?
Yes,
make the proper motion.
Yeah, thank you, President Craig. What this is an increase in the electric tax. According to my calculations, and it all depends on your electrical usage, this would result in an increase for the average homeowner of somewhere between $15 and $30 a year. The numbers will vary depending on your electrical usage. It's a relatively small increase. It does provide about $170,000 in additional revenues. A lot of that comes from businesses in the area. At this point in time, obviously, the village finances in general, are a major issue. People are very much concerned. You know, I get emails, calls saying we've got to do something drastic, whether it's laying off employees or cutting pay or whatever it is. I've discussed this with village manager Niemeyer, and I think the thing that has to be done, or the thing that should be done, and I'm going to make a motion to that effect, is to not vote on this tonight. You know, first of all, I think we need to let the residents of Oak Brook have a chance to comment on it, but more importantly, we're in the process of better understanding what's happening with our sales tax revenues, which have historically driven in support of the village of Oak Brook. And our December sales tax revenue will arrive in March. December, of course, is the biggest sales month. And by March, we should have a much better feel as to where we're going to stand with our sales tax revenue and just how badly this electrical tax will be needed. My recommendation is we hold off on this and perhaps have a committee of the whole meeting in March where we review the entire budget. When we pass the budget, for those that attended those meetings, you may recall we said that in the March-April timeframe, we would review it because we weren't sure what was going to happen with sales tax revenue. And my recommendation is that we hold off on this, and in March, assuming that the December sales tax revenues are available, we review the budget and figure out what really needs to be done.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Clerk Prusa, roll call vote.
Are we voting on removing it from the agenda?
Right. It's motion to table.
Motion to table. Okay. Trustee Manaski?
No.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Sanford? Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is the award of contracts. Golf course commodities. Trustee Manaski, would you please present the golf course commodities and make the appropriate motion?
Yes, thank you. This is a package of five companies, who bid on turf, I believe it is. Is that right? And Sean, could you tell us why five companies need to supply turf? Is it too much for one?
It's just not turf. It's all commodities. It's seed. It's fertilizer. It's flags. It's tee markers.
Oh, flags and tee markers. So
it's all golf supplies.
Okay,
not
thank
just
you.
Turf.
Okay, well, all right. So they're getting ready for the season, and you need your materials, right? Okay, we have a pretty thick bid package here. So I move that the Village Board award requirement contracts to the following five companies: Arthur Clayson, Wheeling, Illinois; Bojo Turf Supply, New Lenox, Illinois; Chicagoland Turf, Addison, Illinois; Eagle One, Anaheim, California; Growing Solutions, New Lenox, Illinois, subject to staff review based on unit prices bid by the lowest responsive and responsible bidders as indicated on the attached bid tabulation. Each recommended bid is indicated in bold on the tabulation. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. If anyone wants to see this, we have a pretty thick packet of all the bids.
Is there any discussion? Clerk Pruce, may I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Next item is a 2009 paving project. Trustee Woolen, will you please present the 2009 paving project and make the appropriate motion?
Yes, thank you, President Craig. The paving project, the economy is in trouble. That's the bad news. The good news is that if you do go out for bid, the bidders are hungry. And we had 10 bidders on this contract, and the bids came in below the engineer's estimate. This work is some much-needed work, was previously discussed. There's a small section of 22nd Street near the 294 tollway. This is not the major repaving of 22nd Street, which is direly needed, but which will be paid for and done by the state. 38th Street, there are four blocks approximately that will be redone. Regent Drive from Oak Brook Road to the bridge, about a half a mile. And then the bath and tennis parking lot, which is way past due and getting repaved. I move that the village board award a contract to the lowest responsive and responsible bidder, K5 Construction Corporation, Lamont, Illinois, subject to staff review for the 2009 paving project in the amount of $598,176.25.
I'll second that.
All right, any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Willen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Minaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is GIS Consortium Agreement. Trustee Carson, would you please present the consortium?
The staff are bringing back to us after our previous meetings a request to approve the GIS Consortium, which is essentially, for those in the room, is an electronic database to access various pieces of information, by location, map location. We've talked about this at great length. There's been a lot of questions in the past. There's been information provided, by the staff to, provide clarification. We've looked at other villages, those that have and those that have not participated in the consortium. However, all things considered, the staff have come back and said they would like to recommend that we do, in fact, participate in this consortium, that there's financial advantages in doing it. And I think the difference today, probably more than anything from all the materials we've looked at, and it's a very sizable package, actually, and I know we can't go through that again, take a lot of time at this meeting. But the big difference is that they're suggesting, since we don't have a lot of experience with it at this point, that we review it, in January of next year. And in the event, for some reason, we miscalculated the need, for this, or this is the or this approach, that we could reconsider it at that point. But at least we jump in, get some familiarity with it. The initial investment isn't all that great, and it was budgeted and planned for, for quite some time. So with that, I'm going to make a motion. Is this one motion for these different components, or are we talking about four different motions here?
Four motions. Yeah.
Four separate motions? Okay.
Yep.
All right. Let's start. The recommended motion, I move that the Village Board approve membership in the GIS Consortium by approving the following subject to staff review. This is the first motion. Membership agreement for a geographic information system consortium, GISC, which is included in attachment one.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Minaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Willen?
Yes. Okay. The second motion. I move that the Village Board approve membership in this GIS Consortium by approving the following subject to staff review. GIS Consortium Service Provider Contract with MGP, Municipal GIS Partners, Exhibit B of the Membership Agreement, Attachment 2.
Second.
Discussion? Call
board,
please.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Minaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Willen?
Yes.
And Trustee Carson?
Yes. Okay, the third one. I move that the Village Board approve membership in the GIS Consortium by approving the following subject to staff review, waive bidding due to sole source, and authorize payment of the one-time member initiation fee in the amount of $12,000.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call vote.
Trustee Minaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Willen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Okay, and the fourth and last, I move that the Village Board approve membership in the GIS Consortium by approving the following subject to staff review. The Village's membership in the GISC is initially for the year 2009, with continued membership to be based on a first-year summary presented by the staff and reviewed at the Village Board meeting in January of 2010.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Next item is new business, confirmation of appointments. There are none. Ordinance and resolutions, there are none. Award of contracts, library books, audiobooks, DVDs, CDs, and other audiovisual materials. Trustee Syed. Thank you.
Pursuant to provision of Title 1-7-10-10, our village code, we are permitted to join with other government units in order to benefit from cooperative purchasing arrangement. The vendors, the brokers are unwilling to submit bids directly to village since they could not offer a better discount than what they already offer to DuPage Library System. So keeping in that, I would like to make a motion. There are four different motions, so I'll just go with the first one for the books. I move that Village Board waive bidding and issue purchase order for books and non-print media to Baker and Taylor, Brodart and Ingram, taking advantage of the cooperative purchasing agreement or arrangement negotiated by DuPage Library System with major book jobbers.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? Roll call vote.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Second motion. For recorded books, I move that Village Board waive bidding due to sole source of library use ready, audiobooks, and issue purchase order to recorded books to Random House and BBC audiobooks.
Second.
Discussion? Clerk Bruce, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Third motion. I move that Village Board waive bidding due to being a preferred provider and issue a purchase order to Midwest Tape for supply of DVDs and CDs.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Finally, I move that Village Board waive bidding due to sole source and issue a purchase order to Scholastic Library Publishing for supply of Grolier books.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is the 35th Street water main replacement. Trustee Woolen, would you please present the 35th Street water main replacement and make the appropriate motion?
Yes, thank you. This is a water main on 35th Street between Myers Road and Cass Court. There have been a number of water leaks, and it's time to replace it. In that vein, I move that the Village Board approve the attached agreement with James J. Bennison Associates, Incorporated for Professional Engineering Design Services regarding the 35th Street, Myers Road to Cass Court Water Main Replacement Project in the not-to-exceed amount of $44,739.
Second.
Discussion? Clerk Bruce, may I have a roll call vote?
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manaski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next item is the 2009 Taste of Oak Brook Consulting. Trustee Manaski, would you please present the...
Yes, thank you, President Craig. As everyone knows, we again are hosting the Taste of Oak Brook, which was a huge success last year, mainly due to the weather. We had about 30,000 people come out and enjoy the food from our local vendors and then the fireworks. So we are doing it again this July 3rd. And again, McDonald's has graciously agreed to underwrite our costs with a contribution of $50,000. To help us plan the event, we are going to hire a company called Tamar event planning group. And last year we used an event planner, and it was fine, but Tamar Productions works closely with McDonald's, and so we interviewed them, and they indeed have a lot of experience. The price is the same this year from last year for the event planner. So having said that, I move to approve Taste of Oak Brook consulting agreement between the Village of Oak Brook and Tamar Productions in the amount of $14,000.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Clerk Fusmayer, roll call vote.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Mnoski?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next is information and updates. Village Manager, do you have any information or updates to impart?
Yes, President Craig. Let me talk a little bit, if Trustee Woolen discussed a little bit about our village budget. And I think maybe it's important to tell residents a little bit about kind of the staff's efforts in here. The board is aware of a lot of this, but we certainly as a staff are certainly taking the fiscal downturn very seriously. I think as many of our residents are aware, in our last budget, we did eliminate a number of positions in the village budget. And we actually have taken further steps beyond that so far in our 2009 budget. Just to be very conservative, we've done some things. For example, I've basically stopped for this year all out-of-state travel. We're making efforts to curb overtime. Ended our a benefit that we give to employees for tuition reimbursement that we used to give before. And the board a couple of weeks ago directed us to bring any hires for any vacant positions to the board, which we're going to do. But frankly, at this point, we're taking the attitude that when positions coming up, we're not necessarily coming to the board right away to get them filled. So we're monitoring the situation carefully. The staff is on top of it. We've had discussions, and we're looking at large things from not filling positions to little things like not having little plastic water bottles in front of the board table anymore. And we're encouraging and directing staff to look big, to look little. But we're going to continue to monitor the situation. We have, and I want to emphasize, as I talked about in budget, we are a healthy community. Very few communities could talk about, the tax base that we have upon having a six-month reserve, which is the envy of almost any community in the Chicago area. But nevertheless, we'll continue to monitor the situation. And if further adjustments need to be made to the board, need to be made to the budget, we'll do those. And we'll be ready to make those changes if need be. So that's all, President Craig.
Thank you. Village Clerk?
Voter information. Last day to register to vote for the April 7th, 2009 general election at Village Hall is Tuesday, March 10th, 2009, exactly 1 month from now. The grace period for voter registration and voting is at the DuPage County Election Commission, March 11th through March 24th. And be prepared when you go out to the county, they'll ask you also to vote. If you need an absentee ballot, you can call me or call the county at 630-407-5600. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, my comments. Last meeting, and this was dealing with what Trustee Woolen was addressing, were about the federal litigation over the Priory. I bring this up again to remind the people of Oak Brook. The huge financial burden was averted because the jury found in our favor. He didn't mention the money again, but it was $13.8 million. That's a lot of money. And believe me, it would have really put us in a bad, bad position. I asked our fire chief during the last 2 weeks what it would cost for an ambulance to service this area when the department or the DuPage Housing Authority builds. It'll be from $700 to $1 million to institute an ambulance to come in and service that area, and that's only the beginning. But I believe that some members of the present board, as constituted, wanted to avoid blame over the legal bills expended in fighting in that case, and I suppose they have. It was directed toward me, as I'm the only person on the village board who voted on the original matter back in not-so-distant past, so the blame was heaped on my legacy. So where is this board headed? What's this board legacy to be? I know this. During the past week, the village received a legal bill from the law firm of Safeworth and Shaw. For those of you who don't know, the present board hired Safeworth and Shaw to handle labor negotiations with the union representing the village's firefighters. To date, the firm has been billed the village over $170,000. When this issue was up for discussion, it was my wish that our current village attorney, Mark Sturck, and his law firm handle the negotiation at an hourly rate, and that would have been one half of what the village is paying Safeworth and Shaw. Mr. Sturck's firm has handled negotiations in other municipalities and is more than capable of representing the village interests here. But for some reason, we needed a high-priced firm to tell our firemen about their pay and the working conditions. Thus, the board hired Safeworth and Shaw. They say the lawyers in these firms are the very best. Well, that is yet to be seen. And I can tell you, we're paying too much for advice for a little in a way of results. I've always found Mark Sturck's advice and legal ability to be right on the money, and his billings have been more than reasonable. I know Mr. Sturck could handle these negotiations in a much more effective and cost-effective way. As all of our actions need to be and will be judged in the sunshine of a brighter day, I wanted to make clear that these legal bills should not be tallied against me or my legacy. And speaking of legacy, I also want to talk about the legal bills submitted by Kevin Quinlan and Mrs. Mullins. As blame avoidance is in vogue, I want to point out that I do not have a vote on the issue of these legal bills. While that might be a little inaccurate, I vote only in the case of a tie, in the event of a tie, and I'm prepared to cast a vote. Kevin Quinlan, as we know, was the former village president. And though obviously I may not have agreed with Kevin on every issue in relation to the village, I do know that Kevin offered the village his time, his loyalty, and his leadership. And Kevin was dedicated to his role as president, and I believe that Kevin loves his village and the people that live here. Kevin has now submitted legal bills to the village that he's incurred as a result of a lawsuit filed against him by Irma, questioning whether a civil rights case filed against Kevin and the village involved his duties as president. I would like to add that the civil rights case was recently settled by Irma under very reasonable terms, that do not require the village to contribute any money to the settlement. But in my opinion, Kevin's bills incurred in defending himself against Irma need to be paid, although not at an hourly rate requested by his attorney, possibly, but comparatively, Kevin's request is reasonable. And to the trustees who vote, please get this matter resolved. Now, Joan Mullins likewise incurred legal bills defending herself in a civil rights case. When her first bills appeared, many of you here wanted to pay them. I, in fact, did myself. Immediately, but I believe sticker shock may have diminished any of your willingness to pay your legal fees. I have encouraged this board to work with Joan to settle her claim and to continue to urge the board in that regard. And I'm very, very emphatic when I say, however, whether the board pays Joan's anything at all is strictly up to this board. And I have no vote on the matter except to break a tie. Finally, on another topic, I want to point out that some members of the village board want to spend a small fortune on a new sign and beautification, a sign that would cost between $65,000 and $90,000. It's my opinion this money could be spent in other, more productive ways, especially when we're laying off firemen or thinking, not laying them off, but we're faced with a budget crisis, firemen and policemen, public safety, and that could be used. I've talked to Mark Stirk, and there are ways of doing that, and I hope if we get a new board, we'll do it. In fact, Trustee Syed submitted a great idea that these funds should be spent on advertising to attract people to shop and eat and stay in Oak Brook. But that idea was $50,000, was dismissed as unworthy. One trustee has presented a proposal to build an expensive sign on 22nd Street, welcoming people into Oak Brook as if they didn't know where they were. Another trustee wants to use the money to plant more flowers when flowers can be planted. Well, these are all very nice. I agree with Trustee Syed that the money should be used dynamically and use the money to advertise all things great about Oak Brook and advertise things that make Oak Brook a special place. At this point, I think I'm going to say thank you and good night, and I'm looking for a motion to adjourn.
I would like to speak.
No, you're out of order.
I move
the president yet.
I move to appeal the decision of the chair and allow the trustees to speak.
You're out of order, and I'll have you removed if you keep that up. This is a president's comment.
He is not out of order, sir. Mr. Stirk, do your job.
Well, if he appeals it to the board and the chair wants to let him speak, that's the chair's prerogative.
And it is not my prerogative to let you speak or your friend Wolin.
There's an appeal
either.
Of your ruling, John.
Well, sue us, because that's usually what you would recommend.
Point of order.
No, point of order, you'll be removed. Is there a...
What's the point? What's the point of order?
John, I think you're getting...
The point of order is...
Out of control, John.
I mean, in Robert's Rules of Orders, which we are governed by, is that correct?
Right.
There is a motion to appeal the decision of the chair...
Okay.
Right.
...for whatever reason, including allowing trustees to speak.
Okay.
So why aren't we not allowed to make that motion at this point in time?
And who considers that motion? Obviously, you're all well...
It's put up for a vote of the...
I mean, you're all well prepared for something that was, the subject of which was not broached with me before the meeting. So I have to admit that you're catching me a little bit flat-footed here. So can you tell me what the rule of procedure is that you're discussing?
I'd be happy to read it.
Sure.
Okay. Give me a second. Page 118 and 120.
I don't profess to have memorized the entire Robert's Rules of Order.
I think trustee should be given opportunity to...
Yeah. Appeal from the decision of the chair.
Pardon?
This is from Robert's Rules of Order.
Right.
You can read it yourself. Purpose: to disagree with the chair's ruling and let the members decide the disagreement by taking a vote. It needs a second. I believe it was seconded.
Okay. So
motion must be made at the time the ruling was made. It's debatable. We can have a talk. We can debate it if we want. It's not amendable. A majority or tie vote sustains the decision of the chair.
So your motion is to...
allow the trustees to speak.
Okay, and is there a second then?
Second.
And then is there a discussion on the motion? If that's the rule, they're entitled to.
And that's the rule. Like I said,
I have to admit that over 30 years I haven't taken the time to memorize Robert's Rules of Order. Obviously, you were all prepared to raise this point tonight, and I wish I wish that somebody would have broached the subject with me before the meeting. I take you at your word if you say that is the rule. So you have a motion and a second. Are you asking for a discussion on the motion?
I'm sorry, what?
For a discussion on the motion.
No, just take a vote.
Take a vote. Yeah, the motion is to allow the trustees to speak.
Take the roll call vote.
Trustee Carson?
Yes.
Trustee Kennedy?
Yes.
Trustee Manosky?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Wolin?
Yes. Okay.
This should be fair, you know?
Yes.
Yeah, I'll begin by talking about the Safe Earth and Shaw bill. President Craig is correct. The trustees did interview an attorney from Safe Earth and Shaw, and also an attorney from Mark Stirk's firm to discuss who would work with us relative to the fire department negotiations, and I think the police, if I remember correctly. It was a unanimous decision by all four, by all six trustees, that the Safer and Shaw attorney was far superior, far superior. Mark, I agree with President Craig. Mark Sterk has done a very good job for Oakbrook. However, it was not Mark Sterk that was going to represent us. It was another associate in his firm. And that associate was not, well, let me just say the Safer and Shaw person was very impressive, had a command of all the facts. Yes, we are paying him more, but in the final analysis, we'll pay him and overall come out financially ahead. In addition to which, it probably is true, I haven't checked the numbers, but it probably is true that we have spent $100,000 plus with Safer and Shaw.
But $174,000.
How much?
$174,000.
$174,000. Of that, though, I believe, and I will stand corrected.
December of 07.
Okay, I will stand corrected. How much of that was for the fire department negotiations where Attorney Stark was going to have an associate talk? Am I correct in assuming it's a very small percent? Do you have, Blaine, do you have the number?
It's $912.50 to date.
Okay, so for the negotiations, which President, or for the hiring of Safer and Shaw for the fire department and police negotiations, we have spent $912 to date. The other $174,000 is for other matters where the decision was made a long time ago to hire them, and my guess is it's very worthwhile.
I have a bill here that says you spent $21,000 last month on all fire. There it is.
It's for the litigation.
From Safer and Shaw. $23,173.89 on February 2nd of 2009. It all description, legal services regarding the fire matter in December of 2008. Legal services regarding the fire matter, that was $1,003. Then we come to legal services regarding the fire matter in December of 2008. $18,663.94. What?
It's not the union stuff.
No, it's not.
It's the fire department. Is that correct?
It's Safer than Shaw. It's with a former employee in the fire
department. Yes. Nothing to do with the negotiations.
Relative to the negotiations with the fire department, the expenditure to date, based on what Blaine is saying, is $912. That was the only thing that we interviewed Mark Stark's firm for.
Can I have a say?
Sure.
I think, John, let's not make it political election time, throwing all the stuff salvos at us. We are doing our job, and you're just accusing us for different reasons, including the Mullen case, you know, that you have nothing to do.
He was up here talking at the podium?
Where? What?
What? What? Where were you when Volin was up here talking
as
the president?
He was talking as a resident. We can't interfere that time.
As a president.
Mark, can you call over there?
What you're doing is totally wrong. This is election time. You're just trying to put us down that we are not doing our job. And first of all, this number was totally off the ball. You know, it was $900 versus $170,000.
Well,
that was litigation. Litigation going on for so many years.
For $22,000.
That was litigation before us was going on. That's the one.
This is right now, this month.
It's not for the negotiation. Can you explain to him?
Legal services regarding the fire department.
Can you explain to him, please?
The 912 is for labor. The rest of it is for former
litigation
related to a former employee in the fire department.
So get your facts correct and then accuse us, you know.
All right. You want to say something, Kennedy?
I'm going to say is that I would like to see a greater level of courtesy at this board table.
Right.
4 years ago and before, we had major problems at this board table. When Kathy and Bob Sanford and I came in, we made sure, and joined by Jerry and Jim and Moyne, that these became civil meetings. I don't appreciate the tenor and the tone of what's going on in these last two meetings, John, and I don't understand why you're doing it.
Well, I can tell you this. I have sat here for 2 years and listened to things that really upset me, and I haven't said a word. I've made peace with this board and tried to, but when it gets to the point that they're over the line and they've spent so much money and we have public safety on the line, I don't think we should be planting flowers. I don't think we should be building signs. And that's my feeling. And I'm sorry if you don't agree with that.
No, it's
or
just
you
the
don't agree with it, but that's the way I feel. Public safety, and the needs of the people of Oak Brook are more, in my mind, than planting flowers and planting signage to say welcome to Oak Brook. Now, yes.
John, I just want to add, I think, you know, whether the technicality is we're voting and you're not or whatever, or you're split time. We've had many, many long hours up in that room where it was particularly participative with you and everyone else, and I think it should continue that way. My interest is seeing us work in harmony. I think that's key. I think, you know, we have in many ways and at times. I don't know what's happening right now and why you're feeling the way you are, but your opinion is valued by all of us at all times, including the closed sessions. I don't know what's different and why you feel it's any different than that.
Well, I try to explain it. Obviously, I'm not articulate enough to describe it, but that's the way I feel. I'm sorry.
Well, then we should start fresh. I mean, you know, considering this as a time to talk this through, because I think that's in the best interest of the residents of Oak Brook.
Yes, and I believe in transparency. I believe in doing it in front of the people of Oak Brook and on TV. I really do.
And hopefully that's where we're going from. It's a good,
right.
It's a new
now
start.
Now, do I have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All in favor?
To make the motion.
I'll move to adjourn.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Adjourn.
You're cordially invited to enjoy the wide range of activities and events that take place at the Oak Brook Sports Core. The golf course is challenging to play and beautifully maintained, including an all-grass driving range and three putting and chipping greens. Membership provides access to three swimming pools and 11 clay tennis courts. Have your next corporate picnic or sporting event in our open field. And every Sunday from July to mid-September, you can watch polo matches on our historic polo grounds. Call the Oak Brook Sports Core for more information.